Okay, here we are, guys. We've found our mountain, and we're breathing in and out, and calming breath in and out. Yeah, I need big time mountain today, because I hit my rage point earlier today. Could not take it anymore. Could not take the frustration. I was done. And the pettiness of stuff in gaming is really getting to me lately. Really, really, really getting to me. It's not a particular issue. It's not a particular person necessarily, although some people have royally pissed me off. But it's the pettiness. You wanna get me mad? Be petty. Okay? Be petty. We're gonna dump the game audio down a little bit because I'm afraid it's a bit loud. So hopefully that'll be better now. I don't want it to compete with my voice because people complain about that. I'm so sick of complaining. But I could rant. I was ready to rant. I was really ready to just rip. But you know what? That doesn't solve anything. It doesn't solve a goddamn thing. There are too many people just complaining and not showing any leadership in terms of solutions lately. So, all I'm gonna do, because people are spreading some stupid rumors about me again. Because some people think that's all I exist to do is just address the dumb shit they make up about me. And it is. It's completely made up. It's based on nothing but guilty consciences and fear. Some of it is, in fact, the exact opposite to what the accusation is. So let's get started. From the Gamergazi side, there's this stupid rumor that keeps going around that I was mocking trigger warnings. And I had somebody coming at me on Twitter today that, how dare I? I'm not an authority to talk about trigger warnings. Well, the background on this is this comes from me being on Sargon of Akkad's stream. And I thought it was a very good stream. I will totally stand by everything that happened on that stream. It was a good exchange. Oh, hey, Rhino. It was a good exchange of opinions, as far as I'm concerned. Step on the grenade, Rhino. At least the rhinos are smart enough to turn around and run away when shit gets real. What the hell was that? What just blowed up there? Oh well. But so we were doing this stream and the topic of trauma trigger warnings came up, and there are a lot of people that are very down on them. And I have not been able to understand this, so I spent time talking to them. And, you know, we reached a consensus. The consensus reached with two people being against trigger warnings and me being the lone voice in favor of it was that they don't hurt anybody. They cause no harm. So people don't have any inherent problem with them, provided they're not handled like pageantry. Like they're not done in such a way that it seems like a show instead of a legitimate attempt to help people. And I have no problem with that compromise. Like I said, I completely stand by where we got to with that discussion. I think that's super productive. If it's something that everybody can get behind, awesome, I'm all for it. But some people with agendas of their own decided to go on the charming pit of online hell known as Gamergazi that exists only to oppose Gamergate. It has no objectives of its own other than to oppose Gamergate, and something is eating me. Oh look, Gamergazi found me. Fucking battlefish. But someone went on there and quote unquote paraphrased, meaning lied about what was said about that stream, completely mischaracterized it. And so people are now disseminating information across the internet that I was mocking trauma warnings, and how dare I? And this led to a person online insisting that my own PTSD diagnosis was just one experience, and I just lost my shit. Because that one experience was the worst 3 years of my life. And the thing about PTSD is when you learn about it, it actually goes on far longer. It's something that builds for a lot of people throughout your entire life. You need to be prone to it. That's why, as far as people know, from what I've been told, that's why some people get it and some people don't. That's why some people like me got stuck and other people don't. Because we are preconditioned to being prone to it. One experience. I'm not an authority. This is how Gamergazi operates. They take any experience a person has that is inconvenient and just erases it. And then for some odd reason, even though they do that, even though they stomp all over people's life experiences and battles they fought and victories they've won, they just crush them under their metaphorical boot. They just destroy it for their purposes, wherever it's worthwhile. They still think they're the saviors of the video game world. And I have tried to be patient. I have tried to be objective. But at this point, I am just at the fuck you point to Gamer God. Fuck you guys. You turned on Brianna Wu when she tried to look like an adult. You turned on Sushi Lulu when she tried to be an adult. That's what you exist to do. You exist to destroy. And until you accept that, you're gonna keep destroying. I don't think you're bad people, but I think collectively you do some extremely bad things. You are mean and you are petty and you are foolish. And I've seen it in your behavior over and over and over again. Somebody from Gamergazi went after my fucking husband on Twitter in the last couple days. Line crossed. Line bloody crossed. She happens to be someone who knows us in real life and there's a pre-existing beef. But still, she used this Gamergate bullshit to get daddy-like approval from my husband, or try. Well, she's skewering me. That's a girl game I cannot stand. I cannot stand that shit. You hatchet job the woman and then you go after the man in her life. Fuck you. Fuck you to that. Fuck you. So tired of that shit. We have women representing themselves as experts in video games right now on game development conference panels. I haven't heard of them before the past 6 months. Who are you? Why is a person who has a PhD in cyberbullying or whatever the fuck she's doing speaking at a One Reason to Work in Game Development conference? She is not a game developer. I want to hear from game developers. Do we really have so few women in this industry that can actually speak to working in games or want to speak publicly that we have to get someone who's only tangentially related to speak at the biggest developer conference of a given year? Are we really that bad off? Well, Momo's upset because I'm yelling. I don't think so. Because you know what? Amy Hennig doesn't think so. And women who actually make games don't seem to think so. I don't think so. I've been around this block for 10 bloody years in one way or another. So where's this coming from? This idea that we're frightened little lambs that need to be saved. It's ridiculous. But then on the other hand, I'm the damn big bad wolf by some idiot Gamergaters who bit off more than they can chew, and this is absolutely not all Gamergate. Because unlike Gamergazi, Kotaku in Action, and the various other Gamergate forums, most of them, the big forums, actually allowed dissent. And that's why I will not speak of Kotaku in Action as a collective, the way I talk about Gamergazi, because I've seen what goes on Kotaku in Action. Somebody offers an idea, some people agree, some people disagree. So in that case, you can actually deal with people as individuals. You can't, because they allow for individual expressions. I'm okay, Momo. I'm okay. My phone will not stop ringing today. That's another thing that's frustrated me. It's Friday phone. Do you guys get this? Friday phone? That a few hours before the end of business day on Friday, people just start calling And it's usually not very important. They just want to get the call in before the end of the business day. Anyway, that's Friday phone for me. But, and like, so I hope I've made my distinctions clear. And that's why I have my issues with the way Gamergate does business. I actively oppose Gamerghazi. I oppose Gamerghazi with every fiber of my being. Because it exists only to be catty and cruel. Talk about a hate mob. That's the definition of a hate mob. You can't dissent. You have to toe the party line. You can't, you know, you can't say, oh, maybe we shouldn't be so mean to these people. You get banned. You get banned from Gamerghazi for saying maybe we should lay off. I don't know how these boards are even allowed. I know it's free speech. I know how. Intellectually, I know how these boards are allowed to exist, and we have to put up with them for the greater concept of free speech. But in my gut, I find it categorically unfair that a board is allowed to exist on something that's supposed to be an open and public forum that doesn't allow dissent. I think that should be a violation of terms of service. It's Gamerghazi is the queen bees and wannabes model, just working in action. You want to study online harassment, Catherine Cross? Study Gamerghazi. Because they're a poster boy or girl or whatever the hell they are for it. Kotaku in action, on the other hand, allows dissent. I've seen people fight like crazy on certain issues, and I think that's healthy. So I'm not speaking to all of Gamergate when I talk about this, but I am not naming names with people because that just, there are a few people on the Gamergate side that are like Beetlejuice. You say their name three times, they appear and start causing trouble. And there's certain people who are just not worth talking about because the minute you bring them up, you get harassed. And that's not true of all of Gamergate. But the ironic thing was I was trying to make this point in a Gamergate stream that there are certain people that are just bad news and is making all of y'all collectively look bad. And oh my god, it was like, you watch it spin. Gamergate has this thing, because people get freaked out, right? It's this bunker mentality. It's a siege mentality. The minute there's any sort of conflict or anything goes off the rails because somebody acts like a friggin' idiot and can't own it. And I admit it, I got mad in a stream the other night. I got really friggin' mad. I will completely own that. Because I, like anything, I'm sure you guys know, when you set up an interview with things, there are certain conditions of that interview, and one is that people respect my time. If I say I only got an hour and a half, I only got an hour and a half, and don't make me bail from the chat, because then I get accused of rage quitting. Respect my time. The other is, you know, leading questions or gotcha questions, I do not deal. I will get angry at them. And I get angry at Gamergate when people pull crap like that, because this is, Gamergate is a bunch of concerned citizens, and I truly believe that, telling me how to do my job, telling me how to improve my job. But in order to tell somebody how to do their job, you have to show you have some understanding of how to correctly do that job. And when people start violating basic journalistic practices, like don't attack your interview subject, I get pissed because I get pissed at the hypocrisy. And that's the background of the ridiculous Gamergate rumor I'm about to address right now. There's a rumor going around that was brought to my attention that I am somehow planning to do a hit piece on Gamergate. I don't do hit pieces. I don't do hit pieces. Where the hell did this come from? Who are you guys hanging out with that you're afraid that you have a disagreement with someone and they're gonna do a hit piece? Oh, I know who you're hanging out with, and that is what they do. So you guys should choose your friends a little bit more carefully, because I do not do hit pieces. I do pieces that are critical, but they're based on facts and my understanding of the situation. It's not a personal beef settled in an article. That's what a hit piece is. A hit piece is when you're just attacking someone for no good reason. Get your fucking terminology right, guys. I know you're scared. I know you're freaking out. I know you fucked up and you can't quite earn it. But far worse things have been done to me in Gamergate's name. And I don't do hit pieces. So I find your latest little attempt at gossip and your latest little attempt to derail an examination, a fair examination of this whole thing, I find it offensive, both professionally and personally. I gave you my time, and I gave you my honest opinion. And anyone who is treating what I said and what I do going forward as anything but my honest opinion is just, that's a smear. Because why would I bother? If I was interested in doing a hit piece of Gamergate, I could do it without talking to y'all. I do not understand some people in Gamergate's habit of shooting potential allies in the foot and in the gut. Like, you guys just freak out and some go on the attack and it makes everybody look bad. And your mistakes are what end up in the press, you know? And that's not fair. But those of us who know that's not fair, we cannot do anything to correct the neighborhood if you guys keep fucking yourselves in the face. Grow up! You want to win, play to win. You want to fight? Fight like it's your life on the line, not some petty crap. If you're serious about this, if you really want to get things better, if you really want to make things better, be the change you want to see. Because there is real change happening, and there are real positives happening. And I would like the people who played fair to get credit for that. And right now they can't, because there's certain people who are very loud who like to go, I'm Gamergate, when they don't stand for anything that Gamergate is supposed to be about. And I know that you guys can't, fuck you bird, fuck you. I know that some of you guys can't do anything about it. You don't have the fan base. You don't have the platform. I know there are thousands of you out there that agree with me, but you can't change anything within the pro Gamergate camp. You're not powerful enough. I know. I'm not speaking to you. I'm not swearing at you. Okay? I know that. There are just some people that are ruining this for everybody. And it's like I try to say, when you guys start using crummy tactics, you make the other side stronger. Because if you really believe you're fighting somebody without scruples, if you really believe that, and I get into so much trouble for saying this, people are like, you're saying this. No, this is called relating to an argument. It's a rhetorical device, okay? What I'm doing right now is, let's say for the sake of argument that you are right. I will go with you here and say that you're right, that the media is absolutely as bad as you say it is. I'll follow you, okay? We're all pieces of shit, okay? For the purposes, I'm a piece of shit. I'm a hack. I do hatchet pieces on people. I don't bother to do my research. I just mouth off because I love attention. Let's assume you're right. That's who you're fighting. If that's who you think your enemy is, why do you ever expect a fair deal? If you're fighting an enemy like that, trust me, I know from experience, you have to be completely beyond reproach. Because an enemy like that will do anything it possibly can to fuck you up. And that is just the reality. Now, I don't think the situation is actually as dramatic all that. What I see is two factions of very scared people acting out because they're scared. That's what I see happening. And frightened people don't make good decisions, which is why I have been trying desperately to try to pull a small portion of this conversation into a sane and secure place. But you know what? It's not possible. It's not possible right now because there are too many people with vested interests throwing hand grenades on the situation. People who are trying to reenact Law and Order episodes by having police presences at game development conference talks. If we've really hit that point, you know, a police presence is not a solution. It's a stopgap. It's a band-aid. I don't believe it's necessary, but I could be talking on my ass. I don't know. And I'm willing to say, I don't know. I don't know the situation. But when I see people refusing to do talks about video games without a police presence, metal detectors, and searches of the audience, what the hell? There's political discourse that goes on without that, guys. There's town hall meetings that go on with politicians talking about things that actually affect real people's lives, like crime and transit and transportation and roads and shit like that, that don't require this level of security or the perception that there is this level of security. And if this is actually necessary, this is not one group causing trouble for everybody. This is an industry-wide failure. Because if that's the case, why are you letting these people into your events? You're not. I don't believe gaming is like that. And I'm not alone. So if gaming really isn't like that, here I am using that rhetorical device again. If gaming is in fact the safe and secure place that you know, we've all built, that it is the community we built and loved, and, you know, it was the community 6 months ago, it was the community a year ago, it's the community today. I refuse to let the video game community be defined by a blip, by one bad breakout that went far more public and far more toxic than it should have. People need to keep their fucking private lives private. On both sides. You know, that things should not be fought out. These personal things that people are claiming is news. You know why these people from Gamergate freaking out and spreading rumors don't have to worry about anything to me? Because your bullshit's not game news, and I cover game news. I cover games. I cover things about games. I don't cover bullshit. So there's absolutely no reason for me to write about you. None. But I can't help but feel that this fear is a way of making you feel more important and in control of the situation. Because what some people did is, I did a stream, and then there was a big post-stream that I was not invited to. And I was apparently tried in absentia. I had a couple people say, I tried to advocate on your behalf, but, you know, it was 6-on-1, and I couldn't. Sorry. That's dirty, guys. That's dirty. You don't try someone in absentia. If you're gonna critique someone, invite them back. Don't stab them in the back when they gave you your time. Why the fuck do you think press won't talk to you? Cause you do that shit. And I'm unprofessional? Fuck you. And yeah, that was unprofessional, cause this is my YouTube channel, this is me unvarnished. And I have had it, and I think right now, this is actually what's actually needed. It is a big reality check here, a big understanding of what this is actually doing to real, living, breathing human people. Because everybody is all about their ethics and all about, sure, I believe strongly in ethics, but this debate has stopped being about ethics. It's not about ethics. I'm sorry, guys. I'm saying this so you can get it back to ethics, because this is something we agree on, that it's important. But this isn't about that anymore. It's personality politics, because the behavior I'm seeing from some of the people advocating ethics, not all, but some, and it's spilling out into public, and you're getting caught, and it's making everybody else look bad. Gamergate deserves better after fighting for so long than people fucking around freaking out and blowing it for everybody. And I'm not saying this as a supporter. I'm saying this as somebody who knows how much people care about this. You know? Do you know how rare it is to find people who are like, I don't agree with what you're saying, but I defend your right to say it? Do you know where it is? Go ahead, roast us. Roast us. See how far you get. You know? Go ahead, attack people who are willing to give you the time of day more, because they don't 100% agree with you. And that's all this is. That's all this is. There's a criticism you weren't prepared for. You freaked out because you do have bullies in your midst. And they are not indicative of the entire movement, but they are things that you guys have to do something about. Because people are not going to take seriously anyone that does not apply consistent standards across the board. That is ethics. That is ethics in a nutshell. You cannot tell other people how to do your job when you can't even do the very things you're telling people they should do. At some point, the catalysts to Gamergate have to be past events. We cannot rehash them forever with the amount of digging that has gone on. If there was confirmed proof, if there was, you know, proof one way or the other, we would have found it by now. And that doesn't mean stop looking. It means put it to bed for a while, give it a rest, stop rehashing it until there is actual proof that we can talk about and look at. Spinning the same tired arguments over and over and over again with no evidence one way or the other gets us nowhere. We need to move forward. We need to start talking. We need to progress and evolve. We cannot keep having the same fights over and over and over again. That just gets people frustrated and they tune out. And that's what's happening. Slowly, the games industry is tuning out to this crap. It's going to be a footnote. It's literally a punchline now, guys. Well, that was weird. I wasn't even in the water. It's become a punchline on both sides. And it's more fashionable now to stomp on Gamergate to win friends and influence people. It's a funny punchline, you know. But the thing I think a lot of people don't realize is when people talk about Gamergate, they're talking about the controversy. They're talking about everybody fighting in it. They're not talking about one side. They're talking about all the people that decided to put politics over people and went for blood. That's what people think of, and that is not... one side doesn't have a monopoly on that. And if you're actually interested in truth, if you're actually interested in improving the way, and I think that for a lot of reasons, yes, why can't I pick this thing up? Oh, fuck off, demon fish. I think there's always ways news gathering in any industry can improve, and those of us who, you know, have been doing it for years, we appreciate the periodic reminders, because it is easy, it's tiring. Like, I can't stress enough how tiring it can be, because it never stops, right? And it does get tiring, and there is a piece of advice that I was given by a veteran in news, actual, you know, hard news, not gaming news. But what I was told is every story can't be your best gal. That was the advice, and it's true. Sometimes interviews are just bad dates, and sometimes, you know, you can work really hard on a story. You can have a great relationship, and then all of a sudden that relationship suffers a really messy breakup. You lose a source, or you find out somebody lied to you, and the whole thing, you know, the whole thing goes to crap. And the reality is that a huge amount of interviewing is bullshit meter. It's driven by a bullshit meter. You have to sort of decide how credible you find a person, and that guides you. And that obviously is not a science. Yes, there are little tells. There are little tells, but you know, every so often you get someone who is a masterful liar and a master manipulator, and you get played. It's happened to me. I know it, you know. And you know, sometimes it's just that I think people don't also understand how much hustle is involved in making a game. Like how much money these companies have to raise on the outset, and how much of an experiment each one is. And yeah, so I've seen many games show off mechanics they're working on, and then it doesn't end up in the game. And that's not always bad. Sometimes it just didn't work. And I would much rather somebody go, yeah, we put in a valiant effort, it just didn't work. Then, you know, go to the death, make that the hill they're gonna die on. developmentally. Because, like, let's face it, gamers want a good story with smooth mechanics, and some gamers only want mechanics, right? They want a game that's fun to play. Like this one. The story's over. I'm just screwing around. It's a nice little sandbox. I'm goofing around and collecting goat masks. And what would I want them to stand on ceremony and keep something in that made this a less smooth experience? No. People want a game they can play, right? And they want a game that's stable at launch. And I think that, you know, if developers are listening now, they'll listen to the public saying, you know, we'll take less game, but make sure it works. You know, but then, you know, we still have the game's too short or this or that. I think I'd love the industry to get some consensus on stability first. Make a stable game first that people can run on their systems, every system it's released on, including PC. And we have to be forgiving of whatever cuts are required. You know, whatever features have to be dropped to make the game stable. And these are the discussions we're not having in gaming, because we're fighting about who said what with a stupid sock puppet on their hand at a damn Game Awards. And that's why I wish people would stop doing that crap, because it's a distraction. Screw you, Tim Schafer. What's wrong with you? Grow up! Like, we should be having discussions about what is best for the consumer. We should be having discussions about what the priorities are, what people actually want from games at this point of a console cycle. And if consumers are willing to take a shorter product as long as it's stable and fun, fine. People have spoken. The problem is, you got all these mixed messages. We want 60 frames per second, and we want 60 hours of gameplay, and we want multiplayer with character customization, and we want it perfect. No bugs at launch. That's... At this point in the hardware cycle, it's just not possible. They are struggling. Making things run smoothly has been a bigger challenge than anybody imagined, I think. And the relationship between developers and the press is currently too adversarial for developers to openly admit that. They know they're going to get slaughtered. They know they're going to get slaughtered. But if you are a veteran analyst, if you are a seasoned analyst, I've seen, oh God, too many console cycles. You know, too many. Sometimes I feel like I've just been here too long. But why should I leave? Because other people are babies, you know? But every damn console cycle this happens. I mean, the original Xbox, there were issues with it. Remember the controllers? Remember those giant fat Xbox controllers? Remember how we all laughed at that? That happened when the original Xbox came out. You know. We all know about the rocky PS3 launch, but look, it caught up and they eventually made some great ass games on that system. I mean, that system was not entirely tapped out when the PS4 came out. The big benefit to the PS4 for me has been the ease of use with the operating system, with the menus and stuff. It's a very nice system to navigate. So, you know, I can justify the new console on, and, you know, yeah, they want to be future-proof. The thing I love about Sony is they get the technology out before people need it. So when people need it, it's there, comfy, snug, established in their living rooms. That's awesome. But who's out there contextualizing this stuff with consumers? Who has the respectful relationship with developers that we can hold developers to account without being Statler and Waldorf from the Muppet Show and dumping on everything, right? Like, where do we have that? Where's the Katie Couric's of game journalism? You know, Katie Couric's a brilliant interviewer because she makes people so comfortable they slip. That's what makes her good. You know, if you watch the greats, the pre-talk radio greats, the really great interviewers, guys like Charlie Rose and, you know, the 60 Minutes crew, they don't attack their subjects because you get squat out of someone if you put them on your guard. You get a nice little YouTube video that makes you look like a big shit for a week, maybe less, 48 hours. That's what you get in the news cycle now. But do you get content that a consumer can use? No, you absolutely don't. You get a fight. You get drama. You don't get information. And that's what, sadly, gaming has been reduced to nowadays. A cascading shit show of drama, and I am tired of it. That's not why people got into games. Well, you know what? The problem is, some people who are in games right now, they brought the drama with them. We had a nice little relatively drama-free, you know, industry. There were spats, sure, but it was usually over philosophical content, like creative fights. And those are the fights that people should be having. I love it when people are passionate and talk about their philosophies of game design. I learn a shit ton just listening to people who are passionate enough about games to share their design philosophy. And you know what? We're getting less and less and less of that because the number one rule of dealing with the press now is don't say something they can eat you alive over. And this isn't good because, you know, the consumers, when you do direct to consumer, it's not a dialogue. It's you're giving content to people via YouTuber or whatever, you know. The dialogue is being had between consumers and, you know, between YouTubers and stuff like that. It's not with the developers. And I think gaming is at its best when the community is open. And I know that there's issues with corporate espionage. I know they have to be careful not to steal intellectual properties. I know people have to keep their powder dry. But I would love more of those great discussions about design philosophy that we've lost in the noise. That's what I want to see. So I got mad enough to swear my fucking head off about things. I will not apologize for that. I've got a lot of people asking me if I'm remorseful for things. I'm remorseful for showing sincere emotion, for being sincerely angry, for being legitimately pissed off and owning that, saying, yeah, I was pissed. And I'm not gonna be sorry for being pissed because I have every right to be pissed. What's wrong with that? You know, like, isn't this the sort of, the fear of anger is the sort of latte drinking liberal stereotype that we're all fighting right now? Aren't we fighting? Like, in essence, what we're fighting for is the right to have progressive politics without being stupid. And to be able to have, you know, friends with different political leanings without being excommunicated from our various fucking tribes. Like, as a human race, shouldn't we be beyond that? Holy shit. But I should probably wrap it up right now because I've been ranting for a while and we have this nice little calm, serene mountain and it is calling to me. Oh, look, big peak. Look at the light bloom. Look at the flare. This is peaceful. Okay, we're going to breathe in. And out. Big deep breath going into the weekend. And let all the anger drain away. Fuck it, I'm gonna go get drunk.